gentlemen, thank you for coming to our City Council Calexico Community Redevelopment Agency Successor Agency Calexico Financing Authority regular meeting, March 18th, 2014, approximately 6:30 p.m. We'll now have the call to order in attendance. So as I look to my right, Mayor Pro Tem John Moreno is present, who is absent at this point in time, but probably is on his way. It's Councilman Kim. To my left, we have Councilman Castro and Councilwoman Hurtado. So we are present. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. I will lead it for you.
Hand over heart. Ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
It's always nice to keep our thoughts about our veterans and the men and women that are over in Afghanistan protecting our freedoms. Okay, let's move on. Approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
All right. Motion by Mayor Pro Tem Moreno, second by Councilwoman Hurtado. We do have a majority, so please vote. Okay, it passes 4-0. All right, unanimously. Now we move on to announcements and public appearance. But before we do that, no, we didn't have closed session, so there's no deferring to our city attorney. So we'll go on to public appearance and public comments. Not to exceed 3 minutes, ladies and gentlemen. This is the time for the public to address the council on any item not appearing on the agenda that is within the subject matter jurisdiction of the City Council. The mayor will recognize you, and when you come to the microphone, please state your name and place of residence for the record. While members of the public are encouraged to participate, it is unlawful to disturb or delay the council meeting with personal or slanderous remarks. If the item you wish to comment on is a closed session or consent item, please comment now. If the item you wish to comment on is on the public portion of the agenda, we will take your comment when we get to the item on the agenda. Please direct your questions and comments to the City Council. All right, and I go by the white slips, and at this point in time, I have two. And first is Mr. John Romo. Please come forward, sir. Welcome, Councilman Kim. Yeah.
Good evening, members of the City Council. For the record, my name is John Romo. I'm a citizen of Calexico. I was raised and born here. And I address myself not only to the City Council, but to the whole Assembly at large. I am very disturbed in what I'm about to bring up, because it involves me as a private citizen, and it involves unprofessional conduct. And so my comment is this. I'm addressing the council with respect. Due to a personal misconduct and violation of my constitutional rights to participate in activities as a private citizen. Secondly, on the 25th of February, Mr. Custer called me asking me why I haven't been going to city council meetings to address housing issues. I told Mr. Custer that I had never addressed housing matters. Community concerns, yes, but not housing issues. Mr. Custer then went on to make reference about a group of people doing a recall on him, that he had no conflict of interest on the Calexico Transit System, a transportation enterprise that he previously owned, as he stated, and now currently owned by family members. I told Mr. Castro that I heard about a recall being circulated within the city and asked him why he was questioning me. And he that I never call him on any matters due to his lack of sensitiveness. Mr. Custer warned me and said to be careful that it was only a small group of people involved in the issue. Recall, I told Mr. Custer that if factual documents were on record, he had no conflict. If there was no documentation, why worry about it? That was it. And Mr. Custer then said that he wanted to warn me about the recall. Now, I just that Mr. Custer does not understand that elected officials do not threat, warn, or give personal phone calls to a private citizen about their community involvement in community matters, issues, or any concerns. As a reference point, elected officials are open, subjected, unrestricted for public scrutiny, and or hold no power to legal concealment to disclose personal information of self-interest gain. As a consequence, I am now concerned about a retaliation of interference to my personal and private life, either by Mr. Castro or by any other persons, for bringing his unprofessional misconduct to public view. I bring this matter to the public and to all council members that they are accountable for undue actions of authority. It is obvious that actions are being made by personal phone calls.
Just to remind you, your time is up, Mr. Rommel. If you can wrap it up, please.
I'm closing up. It is obvious that actions are being made by personal phone calls to extract information or to make authority decisions, such as the case when Mr. Hodge made a personal phone call to a former police commissioner to remove him of his appointed position, then later apologizes to this commissioner, but never puts him back in office. Citizens, I'm about to be closing off and going out. Dear citizens and city council, you only call a citizen to co-work with. Personal issues are a violation of due process and abuse of authority under constitutional rights. I'm just a private citizen that advocates for growth.
Thank you, Mr. Romo.
And I hope this goes on there.
Thank you. Okay. Moving forward. Mr. Ben Horton.
Mr. Mayor, excuse me. Mr. Mayor, distinguished member of the City Council. The reason I'm here in partially is in reference to the Economic Commission, which I'm the chair on. We have had no meetings because we can't get a quorum. And a couple of the councilmen have appointed people that are not participating. I care about the commission. Before, we were one of the more major commissions. Now we seem to be in a dormant state in reference to the participation of the appointed commission members. And I'm referring to Mr. Kim and Mr. Castro's and the other city council I have talked to about his committee members. I'm hoping that either those two or the council as a whole can look at this, if need be, make some changes. And I hope this will be to the benefit of the commission. I come here as a chair in order to see if we can do something about this. And in a lighter note, I had a meeting, let's say, about 2 weeks ago in Mexicali with the Department of Tourism director, Christian Ibarra. He gave us the opportunity to show off Calexico at the Agro Baja. But we had no information that we could utilize in order to talk about Calexico. I did call to see if we had anything we could pass out. He gave us an opportunity to be part of his booth, which at the time was running about $7,000 to have a booth. He was going to give it to us free of charge, but we had no information we could utilize. And that's one of the things that my commission was trying to work on, to have information to spotlight the city of Calexico. We did do something thanks to the Grand Plaza outlet They help us to put something together in order to show peace, Calexico. I hope that the city as a whole and the council will see about at least having something that we can utilize. Now, they have given us an opportunity to be involved with other activities throughout Mexicali, Yuma, and other places, and there has to be no cost to the city to show light, to show peace, the potential economic, and some of the features that the city of Calexico can offer. I think this is something we should look into and move forward on. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Horton. I agree with you, and we may want to remember that I believe that if three commissioners absent three times in a row, we have the right to remove that commissioner. But we do need to work on our commissions, and not at this time. We'll discuss it, but we're going to move forward on that as a team. Okay, that ends at this point, ladies and gentlemen, the public announcements. I have no others. Okay, so now it's time for general comments by council members. All right, may I begin with Mayor Pro Tem John Moreno.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just want to start by thanking city staff for the opportunity to participate in the JPIA retreat that was held here a Saturday and a half ago. I believe the whole idea, the whole message was to seek to understand, then to be understood. So we as a council are in the process of building team within ourselves by listening, by trying to better our relationships with one another, by trying to have a shared vision for our community. And I believe that after that meeting, we are on that path to success, so that the city of Calexico can continue moving forward and attracting businesses and development, which will in turn help our community grow and prosper. So I thank the staff, and I thank all council members that were there on that day from about 9 o'clock to 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And we got to know each other a little better. We got to know our backgrounds, and I think we're really looking forward to working with each other and making things happen for the city of Calexico. So thank you, council members, and thank you, staff. I also want to thank the Calexico Little League for a fine inauguration day on Saturday, this past Saturday, where at least 300 to 400 children were participating in America's favorite pastime, baseball. We look to improve our recreational facilities. They did look subpar, but nonetheless, the kids were out there, the parents were out there. It was a beautiful day, and I thank Mayor Hodge and Supervisor Renison for being out there and welcoming the crowd. And that's all I have to say, Mr. Mayor.
All right, thank you very much, Mayor Pro Tem John Moreno. Councilman Castro, general comments, sir.
In regards to the appointments with the commissioners, it's been like almost three months that the commissioner from Major H, that they haven't been together. And I don't know why is the reason. I understand the reason is because sometimes the commissioners are fed up because there is no communication, there is no motivation by the administration. And not only that, the other commission related to beautification still are in the same boat. There's no meeting for those commissioners. And I know that people are kind of upset because there's no meeting for those commissioners, those appointers by us. And but basically, I'm supporting those commissioners, but I'm just want you to know the public. There is not only, I believe Mr. Horton mentioned which commission you been talking about, Mr. Horton?
Economic Commission.
Not even three appointments got together on that commission, not even. But Mr. Horton mentioned that, so I believe that's something we as a council, we need to concern on those commissioners. And this is for everybody. And but basically, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments, Councilman Castro. Councilwoman Hurtado, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to say a few things. I'd like to remind everyone I am a tax preparer, and just want to remind everyone that there's something out there called the Affordable Care Act. And the 31st of March is the deadline to apply. We've seen a lot of people applying. It's actually helping a lot of people to have coverage now, and people are actually seeking out those services, not from myself, but from the actual certified individuals that are out there assisting people to apply. Definitely need to make sure and do that before March 31st and avoid tax penalties for next year. This past week, we were called out to an area which was the old Vons shopping center with regard to some of the homeless issues. And we had a meeting, thank you very much, that we were able to pull that all together. There was a lot of concern with some issues that the surrounding areas where the homeless are located behind that center may have caused or allowed to be caused. And so we put our heads together in a meeting and found some solutions. And it basically now is kind of the beginning of finding major solutions for the homeless issues in the city of Calexico. This morning I had the opportunity to speak to Orlando Johnson, and we talked a lot about what happened last week and how we really need to pay some attention to our homeless issue here in Calexico, but in a very managed way. Being sensitive to the homeless individuals, at the same time ensuring that we're providing the appropriate services for the citizens. So we're looking forward to that. I understood now that now the City of Calexico also works with the Neighborhood House in conjunction in a task force. So I asked to be on that mailing list, and so we'll be assisting and participating most definitely. The last thing that I want to say is that I'm very proud to say that I have a cousin, and his is from the Niebla family, and he's coaching. He is the head coach for the Calexico Bulldogs high school varsity baseball team. And he wants me to announce that on, hold on a second.
April 4th.
there will be a CIF San Diego section high school baseball game, and it's going to be the Calexico Bulldogs versus the Brawley Wildcats.
Oh boy.
So anyone who wants any tickets, they are only $15 each. And when you buy them, you also get a ticket to the San Diego Padres versus Arizona Diamondbacks game on Saturday, May the 3rd. So they're going fast, and let's all go out there and support our Bulldogs. Thank you.
That's a good deal.
Yes, it is.
All right. Thank you, Councilman Hurtado. Honorable Councilman Kim.
First of all, I have a, when I used to talk to people, a lot of people still complaining a lot of street and parks. And I believe we've been doing a little better in the park areas, but we are far away to go to meet our needs. And I believe next month come up with another quarterly report from the about the park, park we're doing, what we're repairing. I'd like to see the good of the restore to come out, but I still believe far away to go. And the other one is, I have sad news to notify to everybody, and our school district doesn't have money. And they are might have to seeking to the lay off the teachers and lay off the employees again. And they receive about $9 million more, but they're still short. So I told them to It's not matter of how much you're getting, it's matter of how much, how you're spending, you can use the focusing our children's benefit. So far, I see we're not gonna have a chance to have a swimming pool another year. So be aware about that. It's a sad story. And the other one is, Mr. Moreno was mentioning about the JPI meeting we have, council retreat or council training. And I'm glad to we had that meeting. Finally, the JPIA agreed to us, like language was Mr. Moreno said, the shared vision is based on enough information, bring the table with enough discussion, enough information we have that we can have shared information. We didn't have it. 3 minutes. Then council members has to be discussion time. We have to have enough information to bring the table to make the decision for the community. And the other one is the commissioners. Well, I agree with Mr. Castro. We are last commissioners, they have don't have a meeting. They don't call the meeting, including Major H. And also last of commissioner meeting, they've been had it. Major H, we, council member last time didn't receive the meeting information. We should have all the meeting commissioner meeting information to our email. We didn't receive the Major H ones. And also economic commissioners, my commissioners complain me how this meeting goes on. So I don't want to talk, since they are not elected position, I'm not going to talk with this one. I like to see talk discuss at the closed session what is problem in the economic development commissioner meetings. So looks like my 3 minutes gone. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Councilman Kim, and for respecting the time also. Okay, that leaves me here. Let me see. This past week or so, please forgive me, I don't remember the exact date, but a lot of you knew her more than I did, but I was very aware of this great pioneer, Marsha Menville, had passed away at the age of 100. Truly a pioneer, I know Mr. Jean-Pierre Menville, of one of the three sons. Her and her husband had attended Calexico High School, so it's unfortunate, but may she rest in peace. Mrs. Menville, 100 years old. The JPI retreat, I have to say, I thought that overall it was successful. I think it's always good to get personal background. It allows us to understand where we're coming from and to respect each other. And I was pleased that we were all there. Now I would like to move forward and have another retreat or a workshop in coming together for a shared vision. And maybe I'm out of hand, I should say that for future agenda items. I had the honor of being invited to the anniversary of 111 years of Mexicali as a city, and I had the honor of sitting within the people there, and also attended was Supervisor John Renison, and we were able to meet and listen to the effective speeches of the mayor, Jaime Diaz, and the governor Francisco Vega. Yes, so now, I personally believe that the attention should be here in the city, but we should stop being provincial. And what's extremely important is that we extend ourselves to Mexicali. That's our sister city. And there's a lot to be gained from creating and enforcing and strengthening better relationships. I may be the only crazy one, but I believe that there's opportunity to bring jobs from Mexicali. And I'm not going to give up on that vision. Jobs. So that's the reason why I believe it's important to make connections with our sister city. The Little League opening, thank you, Mayor Pro Tem, John Moreno, and John Renison was present. It was very nice to see those children play, and they're going to have a good year. Councilwoman Hurtado, you're absolutely right about the homeless. Absolutely right. Orlando Johnson had mentioned something about a facility where we might be able to renovate. I would love to be a part of it or be informed, all of us. So absolutely right, we need to move forward with the homeless. We need to help them. Okay, that ends my comments, and now we'll go. Sitting in for Oscar Rodriguez, our city manager, is Nick Servine. Do you have any comments, sir?
Nothing. Pretty routine tonight.
Pretty routine. Pretty routine and pretty short meeting, huh, Nick?
I hope so.
Yeah, that's what it's going to be about. Okay, let's move on. All right, consent agenda. Well, gone over this, I don't see anything controversial about the consent agenda. How about you, Mayor Pro Tem?
I have a motion on its approval unless someone wants to pull an item.
Yeah.
I have some number three, item number three.
You'd like to remove, pull number three, Councilman?
Yes.
Kim?
All right. Unless there's any other items that need to be pulled, I amend my motion and go with one and two.
All right.
Second.
Second. All right. We're going to vote on motions on the consent item one and two. Please vote. Due to technical difficulties. There we go. All right, motion carries, but we pulled item number three, Councilman Kim. And it's the approval of the award of bid to Hacker Equipment Company in the amount of, whoa, is that $309 million or $309,000?
$309,000.
Thank you. For the purchase of one CNG-powered four-wheel broom street sweeper.
Correct.
That we have needed one for a very, very long time. But Councilman Kim, please make your statement or ask your questions about this item.
Yes, I believe this one we're buying from the federal fund, the federal grant, so we don't, that doesn't affect our general fund.
There is a city match, but yes, but most of the money is from the feds.
Mostly portion from the federal fund.
State and feds.
Yes. Yeah. And also, I have a questioning. I believe in 2012, about, yeah, 2012, they have come, this company came with the same broom sweepers.
No, it was a different piece of equipment. It was a sewer vacuum truck.
That was a sewer vacuum truck. This one is, the other one is.
The vacuum
this is sweepers.
That is correct.
So, do they have any specific? To specifically to match it everything, not like last time.
We're getting everything we asked for.
Okay, so we don't get any trouble with this.
I'm happy.
Okay, so we're gonna have a clean street then.
Yes.
Thank you.
No exhaust.
Thank you.
Sure. Okay. Councilwoman Heftalo, question.
I have a very, very brief question that Mr. Kim did not ask. Did we own street sweepers previously to this purchase?
We have two. One is completely down. Another one's under repair right now.
Okay, so there is no sweepers at this point.
That's
operating.
Correct.
That's why I saw you sweeping the other day.
Gandhi and I were out there on the curb.
Okay.
Do they
second, Mr. Kim.
I'm sorry, Mr. Kim.
And if we do then make this purchase, how long does it take to actually receive it?
Yeah, what's the timeline?
I'm not sure, but I think it's going to take about 3 months to order it.
Wow.
Okay. Yeah.
Are we going to do anything with the others in the meanwhile?
We're just greasing them and trying to keep them going.
Okay.
And even after we get this one, we're still going to keep those until.
I have a question.
Go ahead, Mayor Pro Tem.
Madam Councilwoman Hurtado, what color is it?
What color would you like?
Just kidding.
Bulldog color.
Okay.
You're so good choice.
Councilman Kim.
Yeah. I believe grant information I have, I believe we have another car available to buy another one.
Say that again.
I believe we have two car worth of the two sweepers we can buy by the grant we have.
Unfortunately, that was the plan initially, but the state and the feds, they trimmed down their budget and only made so much money available to all the cities, including us. So we were only able to buy this one.
But we already have money. That's what I said. I have a report from the last year.
We
have money for the two sweepers.
Well, this comes from CMAC fund, so it is what it is. We only got a $314,000 match.
So would you check for the grant? Because last year, when I had the grant information, I believe the two car money we have in our budget. I mean, we have a cash for that.
As I said, we did plan on having two, but okay, our funds got cut.
No, I mean, we have received the money. I'm not saying the budget. We received the money. We have money in our bank.
I'll check, sir.
Please.
I'll check.
Mr. Savine,
Yes.
You know, we're kind of kidding around a little bit here, but it's a very serious matter. Are you saying for a period of time we've had no street sweepers?
Yes.
Okay, not casting any blame on anybody, but that's not good at all. And it's, the it's, citizens.
Yes, are, it's old equipment.
But we are trying to correct the problem.
That's
correct.
What's important, finding
no,
solutions.
No, I know, but wow. We hope to have in a reasonable time two operating, or just one, or three? What's two. Your wish, sir?
Two.
Two.
The other thing, too, is that we only have one street sweeper personnel. So we have to steal one from another division. So even if we had two or three sweepers, we just couldn't man them all.
Mr. Savine, I understand the situation, and it's tough, but I think we need to really consider the public need. We really need two street sweepers at least.
I agree.
Because, you know, that debris builds up, and we need clean streets. You know, we need to keep those streets clean in front of their beautiful homes. So let's work hard on that, and I know you are doing that, Mr. Savine.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. All right, so that takes care of consent items. Let's move on to business items.
We have to vote.
Oh, we have to vote, that's right. All right.
Make the motion to approve.
Make the motion to approve.
Second.
Second by Mayor Pro Tem on item number 3. Please vote. All right, it passes unanimously after discussion. Now on to business items. Number 4, the approval of a, let me go to the actual area here. Wait a minute, number 4. Approval of sub-receipt agreement with Calexico Neighborhood House. Okay. And we do have someone from the public that would like to comment on that, Mr. Daniel Fitzgerald. Oh, you're number 5. I'm sorry. This is 4. Anyone? What do we have coming here? Okay, this is number 5 again. Woo. All right, then. Is there a motion for this approval?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Second. Please vote. Wow. Moving on to number 5.
Training helped.
Training helped. And I wanted to say that we need to apply what we learned. And it looks like we're doing that. Very good. Thank you very much, colleagues.
I believe there's a speaker.
Excuse me, Mayor.
I'm sorry. Speaker, Terry, for what item?
It's back on that item, number 4.
Back to item Terry.
There's a clarification.
But you're welcome anytime, Terry. Go ahead. That's all right.
Housing manager for the city of Calexico. It was just brought to my attention an oversight on my part of the agreement for the neighborhood house.
Seven of the agreement. Very good.
I would amend my motion to include that correction.
Second.
All right. So we have to revote, correct?
Yeah.
All right. Let's please vote again. Thank you, Mrs. Nunn. With that correction. All right. Once again, it passes unanimously. Okay. On to number 5. And the requested action indicates here, says, approve sub-receipt amended agreement with Southwestern Community College District, which is the host agency to IVSBDC. And we do have some people that would like to comment or speak on that. And I will go again with Daniel Fitzgerald. Mr. Fitzgerald, Please come forward. Good to see you, sir.
Good to see you as well. Council members, Daniel Fitzgerald. I'm here as the chair of the IVSBDC Advisory Committee and coming to speak in favor of this. IVSBDC, certainly under the guidance now of our director, Carlos Vigari, has really expanded a lot of the services here to the community, being able to teach very important courses here to the members of Calexico who are looking to be able to create microenterprises, expand their businesses, and really be able to find other opportunities for additional financing, be able to grow their businesses. And with, we certainly know here in the city of Calexico, here in Imperial County, we need to start growing our own businesses so that way we're not having businesses come and go and have more of the homegrown businesses. So I'd like to speak in favor of this. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. All right, second person to come up is Esperanza Colio. Thank you. Good to see you once again.
I'm kind of short. Good morning. Good afternoon, Esperanza Colio, Committee on Economic Development for the County of Imperial. I'm here to support the approval of the self-receiving agreement with the SBDC. And the reason why I'm coming in front of you is based on the experience that we have with them in the past. We previously have a grant agreement with the state of California for this type of funding source to provide technical assistance. Many years ago, a lot of the small business microenterprise funds were issued for clients that were not ready and prepared to confront the situation of having a new business. So they were not prepared and they were securing loans that they will have to default on it later on. So it came out to an idea a long time ago, 5 years ago, to put together a technical assistance program in which they will come to the SBDC, prepare themselves to come to a reality of whether or not they will be able to manage a program or a business. And so the state really liked this program. It was developed by Carlos Figari, and it's actually being accepted by the Housing and Community Development, and it has been spread out the word in other jurisdictions to accept this program for being so successful. We were able to provide services to 8 clients in our our past grant, and we're looking forward to submit an additional application so that we can continue with the program. That's about it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, if there's no further discussion, I'd like to make a motion.
I have a discussion.
All right, a motion with discussion.
Let me move to approve it, and then we can second for discussion.
Yeah, second for discussion. All right, Councilman Kim. You're seconding it for discussion, sir. Please discuss.
Well, I need a time to the discussion without the obligation to second it.
What's he saying?
I move that we approve this item. Is there a second?
Is there a second? Not from Councilman Kim.
I second the motion.
All right, from Councilwoman Hertado. Now we go for discussion. Councilman Kim?
First of all, I've been seeing this on graduation rate, how many percent? Or how many persons been graduated? Is there any?
Is there someone you want to ask? Please come forward. Let's do this in a formal manner. Your name, please.
I'm Carlos Vigari. I'm the director of the Imperial Valley Small Business Development.
Welcome.
To answer your question, we took in 108 students in 4 different cycles throughout 2013. 60 of them were actually graduated, which means
about 60%.
This is a 45-hour curriculum. This is not a one-evening curriculum. And we study the entrepreneurship mindset. We talked about finances, personal and business. We talked about being able to market your own business. We did a business plan development, which means I put them through an 8-step program that actually allows them to develop their business plan correctly so they can, when they go out there in the real world, they can actually function and be able to be successful. And then the capstone course is either getting, since our emphasis is getting them financeable with a lender, we get them ready. In addition to that, we gave back to the program over $35,000 in in-kind services, which means they receive one-on-one counseling beyond the actual class time. So it was, this program was very successful. And I look forward to doing it again, and we have done it all in Spanish. So not in Spanglish, but in Spanish.
Okay, I have another question is, we have about curriculum cost, so curriculum salary cost about $15,000 from the $125,000 budget?
It's all, I developed that curriculum, sir.
Okay. I believe the last time we've been charged to develop the curriculum, and why we have to charge again the developing the curriculum again.
Mr. Kim, thank you.
Yes.
We do not deliver an old curriculum. The curriculum gets renovated, gets updated, and I spend a lot of time doing it in addition to the actual class time. So the student does not get all information. They get up to date, and since things change on a daily basis, it gets updated on a daily basis, just like the weather.
Well, I believe the curriculum is based on same ones, but the thing is they're supposed to have every time different things, different changes.
That's what I'm telling you. That's why it gets updated, because it is not what the students can receive now is not what they received last cycle.
3 minutes are up, please. Please wrap it up.
Well, you're talking about the answering time, the counting too?
Go ahead, sir. 3 minutes is up.
That's what JPI didn't say, that now it's coming again. Okay. The other one is, so there's no in-kind budget in here. You're saying the $35,000 in-kind service, in-kind budget, but they're not showing up here.
It was submitted to the state. You know, this is money that comes from the community block grant program, and every minute, every item that was actually done in-kind, it is verifiable, and it is submitted to them for approval.
But I don't see the budget in-kind.
The actual city of Calexico has it also.
But that means this budget is not correct?
No, the budget, you're confusing. Let me help you understand something. The $35,000, that was for 2013.
I understand that.
I gave you statistics for last year.
Yes.
This year we don't have an in-kind because we haven't started it yet. We will accumulate 2014 once we start the cycle.
So that means last year $120,000 was the budget, in-kind service was $35,000.
Yes.
I think Ms. Naval.
Yeah, all right, let's.
We could be here forever.
Yeah, we'll be here forever, but let's just clarify this. Do you have each other's cards? So maybe you can call Mr. Kim for clarification.
I'm happy to sit down with Mr. Kim and explain.
Okay, very good.
The in-kind that was submitted to the state on behalf of the Imperial Valley SBDC has already been accounted for with these grant funds. And because we had money left over and they allowed us to move funds from one project or program to another, they've already met their in-kind service for this grant application.
Yeah, but that's for the last year. We're going to be approving for the...
It's for the grant as a whole. Now, if they want to provide us additional in-kind, which they certainly will, we can add that and it'll give us...
Yeah,
they're
asking the money from the CDBG fund, the grant.
Yes, but they already met their in-kind with the state CDBG, and I'd be happy to sit with you
and
explain that to you. Okay. All right,
you're 3 minutes. My final wrap-up. I believe that we have even the IVC, they have a similar programs.
Seven.
And I'm not sure from the San Diego State University have a similar program. I'd like to see that we spend this money we supposed to spend for the local entity, local service groups, and not from the San Diego entities. And also, this grant is the city of Calexico. Why is city of Calexico not spending for the citizens of Calexico?
Okay, you're kind of
for the value-wide.
Mr. Kim, you're sort of giving a speech
county.
Here.
Yes.
Mr. Kim, point of order. I think you've had enough time. I don't want to engage in any
argument. You don't like it, then you call the point of order. You're not your chair.
Sir, let's
you're supposed
on.
To let the public know
Sir,
enough information.
Sir, let's move on. We're going to move on. Who's next?
I'd like to make a motion for this, its approval.
All right, let's make a motion. But please, Kim, your questions are relevant, but you have two people with phone numbers. You can do this behind. We're taking the public's
there's
time.
There's a motion.
There's a motion.
Point of correction, I made the motion, and Ms. Seconded it.
I forgot you had made the motion.
All right, yeah, it gets confusing. Deep. Okay, so please, let's vote on this. Okay.
Senor Castro?
Councilman Castro.
We're in a meeting.
All right, thank you. Mr. Kim, I understand your concerns, but boy, I don't want to get bogged down here. We're taking the public's time. Okay, let's move forward. Item number six. Authorize the city manager to execute an agreement between the City of Calexico and Pro Record Storage for storage and retrieving of files. Mr. Savini, you have any background on this, or you'd like to make any comments about this item?
I can leave the background here.
The City
of Calexico has been doing business with Pro Record Storage since December 2008. City staff researched for other companies for like services and found Pro Record Storage, the only company in the Imperial Valley providing storage of files, pickup, delivery services. They currently store about 500 storage boxes and provide retrieving and delivery service to the City of Calexico. The city has no storage space available for files. The service Pro Record Storage provides is expeditious and efficient. So the current consideration is to authorize the city manager to execute services agreement with the Pro Record Storage for storing and retrieving of files.
We've been doing business with this entity.
Yes.
Motion to approve, Mayor.
Okay, is there a second?
Second, sir.
Second, once again. All right, please vote. All right, thank you, Council. Unanimously approved. We see that there's a need to move forward on this. Item number seven. Okay, we have a public hearing. All right.
Mayor.
Yes, sir. To Mr. Orlando Johnson? Okay. All right, let me remember the proper order here. We're going to have a public meeting, but before, we're going to have the staff give us some insight on this item. I'll read it, and then we can get some explanation back up. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a public hearing under the requirements of TEFRA, would that be properly pronounced, and the Internal Revenue Code, and adopt the resolution, I think that's a misspelling, approving the issuance for the bonds by the CMFA for the benefit of the Via Primavera, CIC, LP. Can we have some backup or further explanation on this? Do we have anybody?
We have the consultant here that can...
All right, that would be nice. Thank you, sir. State your name. Nice suit.
Good afternoon. I'm Ben Barker with the California Municipal Finance Authority. Tonight we're asking the city to hold a TEFRA hearing, which is the Tax Equity Fiscal Responsibility Act. It's a 1986 IRS tax code requirement that whenever a private entity such as CSC goes out for taxes on bonds, there has to be a public hearing held letting the public know that tax on bonds will be used. These bonds are essentially just a private loan between Rabobank and CIC Development. The only thing the city is doing in participating in this financing is holding a public hearing for us. So the approval of the resolution is approving that the public hearing took place and that the city knows that tax on financing is part of the access.
Sir, may I hear from you clearly? Is the city in any way obligated or have any liability in this manner?
No, through multiple resolutions and bond documents, the city is alleviated. That's the reason this type of structure is used, is to make sure that the city has no responsibility or liability for any of the debt for this project.
All right, thank you. All right, anything else you would like to say, sir?
Take any questions if there are
any. Okay, questions? No, you said it very well. Thank you. It seems straightforward. All right, now we open up for public hearing, and then after the public hearing we close it, we'll come back to council for any comments. All right, so looking at the clock, the big clock on the wall to the left, it looks like it's about 6:20.
7:20.
What happened?
That clock has
We have not changed the time.
Nobody's tall enough.
Nobody's tall enough. We got to get a ladder. Okay, I was actually believing, wow, this is a quick meeting. Okay, actually, we start at 6:30. All right, so it's 7:20, and we're going to change that clock, Mr. Savine. So we open now for public hearing. Those in favor of this particular requested action, you have your right, your democratic right, to come forward and make a comment. Anyone? So sound effects. No one. Ah, very good. Yeah, that's right. We had a speaker, yeah. Mr. Orlando Johnson.
Yeah, Orlando Johnson, Executive Director, Housing Authority, City of Calexico. We're not in against the project. You know, we're in favor of all housing projects, especially in the City of Calexico. We were approached by Chelsea over a year ago in the same project. The problem we had was financing this project. As you know, we have a 5H replacement housing requirement that we have to spend funds before it was December 31st, 2013. But we got an extension. When they approached us on this project, it was for the December 31st deadline. We couldn't make that That's deadline right. with that project. So, you know, I don't know how it came about that the city was approached on it, but probably because of the bonding capacity. We don't have that capacity. But that would have been an excellent project for the Housing Authority, considering the fact that we are in the housing business. Now, my question that I have with this, are the rents going to be fair market rents? Are they going to be subsidized type rents? The housing authorities have the connection with that, with subsidized rent, either multifamily or public housing or Section 8. So my question is, how are they going to do the rents?
All right, that's a good question. Sir, could you answer that?
Sure. Whenever there's taxes and bonds used, there's a regulatory agreement applied to the bonds that is overseen by the state, which means the affordability period is 55 years and it's 60% AMI. Most likely this project will be, so for 55 years, this project will be have affordability restrictions. The rents will be subject to 60% of the area median income, so the rents will be gauged by that. It's the same Section 8 housing, vouchers, HUD, it's all the same across the board. So if there's any other questions?
Yeah, that answers the question, but in most projects, like say for instance the existing projects that on Meadows that Chelsea has or have put in place, I don't think there's very many Section 8 or subsidized assistance over there. I know our housing authority probably has a handful of them, but in a 48-unit project like that, there should be
quite a few. I'm sure they'd like to get Section 8 vouchers put onto the project, but the rental restrictions for Section 8 is virtually the same thing. It's a federal tax code that's 20 at 50 or 40 at 60% AMI.
Mm-hmm.
So it's across the board. This is in the state you go.
It's relatively the same.
Yeah. You are aware that there are no new Section 8 vouchers being issued. Okay, so those that have them can use them, but there are no new ones. So in a project like that, 48 units, you can literally end up with probably four with Section 8. The rest would be, you know, whatever method of calculation that you're using to right. to calculate rents.
It would be low-income housing tax
credits. Low-income housing tax credits. Is that based upon 30% of the tenant's income, or
it's at 60%.
60%
or 50%, depending on the percentage of the project that is affordable.
Yeah, you know, for this area, that's, you know, at 50% and 60%, that's still relatively high. I mean, at the Housing Authority, we use 30% for subsidy. Now, granted, I mean, there's different levels of affordability. I mean, you can start out at that rate, and subsequently end up at a lower rate.
Okay.
I just want to add one thing. I'm Chris Westlake, a project manager of Chelsea.
All right. Good evening, sir.
There are several different levels. There's levels at 30%, 40%, 50%, and 60% AMI levels in the project and scattered throughout the 48 units. This project also has federal home funds that are done through HCD, and the city applied for those, as well as multifamily housing programs. So both those requirements have very low targets for the AMI levels, as well as the 55-year affordability that Ben talked about earlier.
Okay. Yeah, that's the main thing, is making it affordable. I mean, that's our whole premise, is provide affordable low-income housing.
Sounds like they're doing that.
Yeah, no, that's it. Like I said, we're not against the project. We just want to make sure that it's affordable.
Well, I'm glad you both can come together and exchange concerns.
And I'm sure somewhere down the line we'll probably do projects with them as well. But, you know, I would have liked to have seen, you know, the housing authority in this project.
I understand.
With something that size.
But I see.
We're not against the project.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Johnson.
But in the future, I think maybe the city should keep us in mind.
Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you.
I understand. All right. That's in favor.
Yeah.
Anyone else would like to come forward in favor of this item? Mr. Romo, you?
Yes.
Okay, in favor.
Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Romo.
Same name and same residence. I am in favor. I'm a former housing commissioner of 12, 13 years, and I do believe that I agree with Mr. Johnson. We do, in this community, we need real affordable housing. And the question is true. It's if you don't have any Section 8, we don't currently, that I know of, might have changed. We don't have any Section 8 to give. So it would be great. I'm for the project because I do believe in affordable housing. I live in a project, and it's 30%. And but what about those families out there? And this is, I guess, where Mr. Johnson was coming out, and he's concerned. He's all for the project. I'm not speaking for him, though, but I do speak on my own, and I would like to see this go forward and very affordable. And first it was, I heard 60 and 75%. That was lowered down to what, 30, 40, 50?
No, it was 60.
Multiple
levels
of affordability.
Yes.
Some will be 30%, some will be 40%, some will be
60%.
And it depends on their income, where they qualify for those.
Okay. Okay. At what level would 30% come into?
Very low income.
Extremely low. So you are accepting extremely low income?
Yes. The complete project is an affordable project. 100% of the units are affordable units. They start at 20, 30, and up to 60 is the maximum. So wow. When you go from extremely low to low.
Wow.
To high low, to medium low, moderate, high low. I understand.
All right. Well.
So the project is 100% affordable.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. Keep that in record, please.
Sorry. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Romo. All right. Once again, anyone like to come forward in favor of this requested action? No. No longer, but very good. Now we'll move on the other side. Is there anyone that would like to come forward in opposition or to oppose this requested action? No one. Okay. So, do we end the public hearing? And then, okay, I'm learning. We end the public hearing. Oh, that's not six. At 7.
Mr. 30, Chairman,
7,
Mr. Hatch.
27. And now we're going to come to you. Now we're going to come.
No, I'm before the closing of the hearing, I'd like to think of our council, think more carefully to before we make the, without closing, which is table the hearing for the next meeting, to try to get the more information from the people, so that they have a chance to express their concern. Because this, what I understanding this grant, they can use for the build the police, or even fire station, we can use it. We don't have to build the affordable housing. And also, well, probably they don't like, you know, more details I'm gonna talk about my time, but the thing is, I'd like to consider table for the next meeting, the closing the hearings.
Okay, wow. You always throw a good one there, Councilman Kim. I have no idea.
May I respond?
Okay. I'd like to do this and close it, but now we can't? What is he?
Well, if council wants to discuss continuing the public hearing, then yes, you should not close it yet, because you wouldn't want to have to renotice it. So
okay.
If a majority of the council is in favor of continuing this,
continuing.
You would want to do it
tonight.
To a date certain and a time certain before you close the public hearing tonight. Essentially, you leave it open.
All right,
so
we need to discuss whether we're going to move forward tonight or we're going to table it.
Right, you can discuss
okay.
that now.
All right. So Councilman Kim has popped something in there.
And yeah.
So now we can discuss. You heard him. He'd like to table it. Any discussion or comments? Councilwoman well, Hurtado.
This is what we were learning at JPIA training to try to avoid this.
Surprises.
Yeah. I believe that at this point it would be more appropriate to move forward. As you indicated, this is only a circumstance where we are allowing you the use of this area for a public hearing for your purposes. And I would assume that you followed all rules and regulations to notify the public that they had to be here if they were interested. The idea that Mr. Kim has, not that that wouldn't be a bad idea to entertain, however, it is the matter of being so untimely that this idea may be something we want to look at with more preparation. Instead of stopping this project for this agency, this company, in this manner. That's all
right.
All I have to say.
And once again, the public, there were people that came forward in favor, but no one came against it. Anyone else among the council have a comment?
Yes, Ms. Nava.
Can I add one thing really quick?
Go right ahead, sir.
Per IRS tax code, there's a 14-day notice period, so it was published in all the applicable newspapers.
Oh, I believe you.
Through this area, so the public should have had, there's all their information, contact information. And as far as the grant, if this is purely for affordable housing, it can't be used for fire stations. I'm sorry, I don't remember. Fire stations.
Yeah.
This is just an affordable housing.
Yeah, strictly. Okay.
I have a question for Ms. Nava.
Mayor Pro Tem.
Ms. Nava, how does this project align itself with the Calexico housing element?
Good question.
Well, it actually assists us in meeting our RENA needs, our housing needs. We have so many units we have to accommodate the state with or the city with every 5 years, and this would allow us to try to reach that goal.
And we have a lot of housing needs.
Correct. Yeah, we have one of the number one needs in this, the number one need in the city is housing.
Right. So, well, if anyone doesn't have any other questions, I motion for its approval.
Second.
Okay. Second for its approval. All right. All
well,
those in favor, please
well,
vote.
Wait a minute. This one is for the postponing the table.
No, this is a.
Okay,
no,
wait.
This
hold
is
on.
Tabling.
Hold on. Let's go to city attorney. City attorney, please clarify here the situation. Do we vote for or against tabling it, and then we move forward to
make
to
a motion
approve
for
it?
The issues?
I don't believe there was a second to the motion to table.
Was there a second?
There a second?
I don't recall.
I'm second.
So you can vote for the motion to table.
All right, let's vote for the motion
precedence.
Right now, one step at a time. Let's vote for the motion.
It
to
would
eat.
Be motion to table it to,
table.
To April 1st, 2014 at 6:30 p.m.
All right.
Which is our
is
next
that
council?
Accurate?
All right,
that's
yes. our
next
council.
Yeah, next council.
All right, very good. All right, so voting to table it for that further date. Doesn't seem to register.
There it is.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it goes down in defeat 3-2 to table it.
I move that we approve the item as is recommended by
All
staff.
All right, and we have a second.
Second.
All right.
And one
okay.
one clarification is on the
yes,
resolution.
Ma'am.
It should say March 18th of, as the day of approval and not February.
Okay, yeah, that month is long gone. Okay.
Okay, I have a discussion.
There
okay.
is no discussion.
No discussion.
I call
yes,
for
no.
the question, Mr. Mayor.
No.
Mr. Mayor.
No discussion.
His
we're
first
gonna
motion
vote.
Was defeated.
That's right.
Now we're going to
no,
vote
that
on
was,
this motion.
I was
please vote.
Discussion
please
for
vote.
The tabling.
Mr. Mayor,
yes.
I just want to add that with the does the motion include closing the public hearing and voting on the resolution as amended?
Yes, it does. Okay? Let's
move this company making money five ways.
No.
So if you see it as sort of the community,
order.
We can go that cheaper for the community.
You're out of order. You're out of order. Please.
You guys don't let me talk.
This is not the
appropriate
time.
Yes, because we were discussing for the tabling.
No, Mr. Kim, you are out of order. Let's vote.
You are out of order.
Vote. We move
what are
forward.
We voting on, sir?
Okay.
Sorry.
Let's vote.
These interruptions
we're voting
make
on this issue.
We don't agree with you, and that's just the way it is.
Okay.
We don't have to agree with
we
you.
We have just approved, what is it?
Okay, no further comments needed. Please vote. Okay, sorry. We just voted for this.
For the approval?
For the approval. Okay.
For the resolution?
Yes. Passes. 3-2. All right, let's move on. This must remind you, you are absolutely invited to be here, public. I have been taught that this is a city business. It is not a public forum, but I think maybe we should have public forums. You have every right to participate, but my job is to expedite and run this meeting as efficient as possible, not to engage in long-winded arguments. No. All right. Oh boy, here we go. Item number, what are we, 8? Okay. We have a right to comment, we have a right to ask questions, absolutely, but not a right to get bogged down in areas that we could take care of behind the scenes, Mr. Savine. So this is number 8. It is, and yes, thank you, it's informational, ladies and gentlemen. It is recommended that the City Council acknowledge receipt of and file this statement of revenue and expenditures and mid-year review. Okay.
Acknowledge receipt.
All right. This is information. We've done our homework, I hope. But we do have someone from the public that has a right to come forward and make a comment. So we'll do that first, right? Okay. Once again, good to see you. Yolanda Cordero, please come forward.
Well, as the chair for the Finance Advisory Board, we've had a couple of meetings to go over this budget. It sat up to March the 3rd or the 4th of this year. And I just wanted to bring to your attention the following. We had, the city had put up a budget for the 2013-2014. And one particular that I'm going to be addressing that we've been talking a lot about is the overtime with the police department. We had allocated $450,000 for overtime. As of the last pay period of March the 1st or the 3rd of this year, our overtime expenditure is a total of $801,000 for the last 8 months. Our allocation was $450,000, so we have overspent our overtime $350,000. When we did the budget, or when the budget was done, there was a grant that was going to be used to cover the overtime. That grant was $450,000. So we already spent the grant, and now we're going to be eating into the general fund. Now, when the new year started, which was in July of last year, at that time we had 36 sworn police officers, and we had 4 sergeants. There was 2 positions available, and 1 position became available due to a disability / retirement. As of December of 2013, there was an additional sergeant added to the police force. Why, I don't know, but, I mean, when this happened, who approved it and what's the process? You have to remember that by promoting another police officer, you're gonna increase the payroll, which we don't have the money to pay for. Okay, so I don't know if you guys were aware of it or not, but somebody did all this, and you guys are, somebody's not watching the numbers. And now it's, the other thing that we have going on is, from the 36 sworn police officers that we have, there's 2 school resource officers that are being used to help this Calexico School District. As of July 1st of last year, and our year finishes in June the 30th, there's a fee that the school district, there's an agreement, I guess a verbal agreement, that the school district will pay the city of Calexico for those 2 resource officers $242,000. Well, as of this date, the city of the school district has not paid the city of Calexico any money for that, those two school resources. And I know that the school district is also having their own problems. One, we don't have a binding contract with them that it's signed that they should be, you know, that they're liable for it. It's just a verbal agreement. And I guess the school district, I don't know why they're not paying, you know. But we're not in the process right now of giving credit to anybody because we can't afford it and we just don't have the money. Now, if this overtime continues, we have 3 more months left before the year's out. The money's going to have to come out of the reserves. And I mean, we're going to run into a red in about $1 million starting our new fiscal year, July 1st. So what is that going to mean? That's going to mean that we're going to have to, I mean, if we want to get this deficit under control and we want to control our spending, you're going to have to start cutting some spending. You're going to have to put a freeze in all this traveling. You're going to have to cut employees and you're going to have to do some furloughs.
I'm sorry, 3 minutes are up, so just wrap it up.
This is important, you know, this is very important, and I don't think the 3 minutes right now, because this has to be put out in the public. You guys need to see these things, and I don't know if you guys are seeing them or not. There's a lot of discrepancies that are going in within the city of spending, and I'm sorry that Oscar's not here, because, I mean, he needs to put his foot down, and you guys need to put your foot down, and I don't know why you guys aren't doing that. So, again, we're going to be in the red about $1 million, and we're going to get into the reserves. The reserves, there's only about $2 million left, so you're going to eat up into that. I'm not even going to touch the situation with Measure H, and that is all. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Cordero. Okay. This was informational.
Yeah, I have something.
Any more comments?
I have a
Councilman Kim, 3 minutes, please.
Yeah, first of all, I've been keep telling we are short of the employees, officers, 6 officers, even we have a budget. Actually, City of Calexico, we're not hiring 6 officers, so we have a short of the hands. That's why causing overtime. And second, the City of Calexico, 10% of the officer's salary, they're using by overtime because they're using the grant, not the general budget. So try to saving our general budget to be using overtime from the grant. So not affecting our general budget. That's happening right now. And also third, the Grand Plaza, we are pulling more manpower from us to the police officers. So anything's called, the police officer has to be there. That means we need to have more personnel. That's why I keep telling to Grand Plaza it's going to be cost $50 million for our cities.
You don't need to yell, Kim.
I'm not yelling. I'm get the point.
Can you hear him?
And the real story is we short of the hands. We have short of our personnel and causing the overtime, and we have overloaded. We used to have 48 officers when we have a population of 20,000 citizens. And now we have 31 officers. Way down. You can imagine our citizens, we cannot have I have a complaint a lot from the citizens said when they need police officers, they can come because they're busy. Or it takes a better while. Because we don't have manpower. So I believe what I understand is our police officers overtime pay through the what's called the stone garden and the forfeiture money. So actually not affecting our general fund. That's how we probably have to know we need to hire more officers.
Thank you.
I'd like to comment, please.
Okay. Councilwoman Hurtado, comment on
really
this information.
I'd really like to thank Yolanda for the selfless work that she does for our finance committee.
She does, thank you.
It's commendable to know that you meet with our finance department on a weekly basis, and with very few members of this commission, which is what we're talking about tonight before you arrived, that we really need a lot more participation from the individuals that are on these commissions.
As far as what you're seeing, I know that we've had that discussion, and I very much agree with you that there needs to be some management with regard to the overtime. The only thing is that we as council can sit here and have opinions consistently, but what we need is information and reports, the same kind of reports that you're looking at. But there's a part of it that's missing that I've personally been requesting for a while, which is for our chief to prepare a plan. What is your plan? And I keep repeating to everyone that when we had a similar issue of lack of manpower in our fire department, we had our chief in our fire department, Chief Mercado, prepare a plan. And he adhered to that plan, and he followed through. And he was concerned if he was going to reach his goals or not. In this case, it's almost been a year with this new chief, and we haven't had a plan. And we can't allow for this to continue on this way without a plan. And I know that we talked about it a couple of weeks ago, and there was a promise to provide that, but it's not here again. So again, I don't believe it's up to us with opinions on how things are, or anyone else. The plan needs to be presented in order to be able to understand where the spending is going. We have been here for a while now. We know what happened before you arrived. Now we see what is happening here, but as we can see, there is a concern. There is a very severe concern. No, I'm talking to the audience. There is a very sincere concern so that we can once and for all look at this, know where it's going. For example, I had a curious question, how much reimbursement had there been from Stone Garden, but you just already indicated that we've already exhausted that avenue of reimbursement. So it is just a matter of being able to have proper information, just as we did. Do you remember that, gentlemen? What we did with our fire department, let's do that with our police department. It's that simple. And let's move on from there. That's my suggestion.
Okay. I'd like to comment.
Go ahead.
Chief, I've heard you explain the plan, but maybe it would be a good idea on paper. I don't think it's necessary, Chief. We've gone over this over and over again. We did get something from you. I respect Mrs. Councilwoman Hurtado, but I totally agree with Councilman Kim. Fire department had a plan. They need more firemen. Police department has a plan. We need more police officers. We're understaffed. I'm fearful for our public safety. And we've had promises from city manager, and I know he'll carry through the Measure H, that's already a done deal. We're going to get those, the sergeant promotion, and the positions that were already budgeted should be filled. I believe, and I've seen the figures, and it'll work just like the fire department, even though it's somewhat a little bit different. Once we have the men, the appropriate men, that overtime, Chief, and I'm going to hold you to it, will come down, and I know you will keep your promise. And I know we have a disagreement here, but that's my statement. And so I think we do need to, what was the saying here? We need to put our foot down and get those officers so that we can bring down that overtime. Let's put our foot down on that and get the officers in. So that's my comment. Anybody else?
Yes.
We've had three. Go ahead, Mayor Pro Tem.
Mr. Quinn. Just a couple of questions. We heard from Ms. Cordero about the overtime. Would it be ideal at this time to freeze overtime across the board?
Good evening, Mayor and members of the council. Freezing overtime should be one option and a very high priority, I believe. You're not going to be able to do it completely because there are cases, especially with police, where in emergencies and sometimes just the fact that certain events happen when they do, the overtime is necessary. However, it is absolutely necessary that we take better control of it right now because we're running out of money. When we get the fiscal year 2012-13 audited financial statements next week, you're going to see that we have a $600,000 operating deficit. There are a lot of reasons why we have it, but we have the deficit. I'm projecting that at June 30th this year, we're going to have $1 million deficit. And yes, we can have reserves cover all of that, but we only have about $2 million in reserves. And once that's gone, I don't know where you're going to get the money to even make the payroll. And for any of you who have been in business and had to make payroll, it's kind of scary when you have to do that and you don't have any funds in the bank. You have to go sell your soul to the banker. You have to put a mortgage on your house, a lien on your house. You find yourself in very difficult straits. Right now, since I've been here for a year and a half, I've asked, I've cajoled, I've yelled, screamed, we have to cut the payroll. It's $16 million. Our deficit is going to demand that we cut the payroll. I personally don't think furloughs will work, but that's a decision, a policy decision for the council to make. But as I look forward, the overtime needs to be cut across the board. Police is a big offender. And yes, the grants pay for it, but right now the grants that are paying for overtime are overrun by $350,000. That's going to be contributing to the $1 million deficit this year.
So I understand a couple of, maybe a month or two ago, there was a meeting that Oscar talked about that he was going to meet with Chief yourself to deal with this. Did anything come of that?
The meeting I was in, nothing really came of it.
So it was business as usual?
Business as usual. I can't tell you, I'm sure you all know or remember, or I'll remind you that we had a $600,000 increase in workers' comp last year that we had to absorb. This year we're going to be absorbing double-digit costs in our medical health plan. And we're also going to probably be absorbing double digits in workers' comp increase. And there's no, and the CalPERS is going to be double digit as well.
So perhaps a freeze in overtime, perhaps a freeze in hiring, perhaps a reduction in force is what we're looking at.
We've already essentially frozen hiring except for police and fire.
Then I think this matter is of urgency that we need to discuss with Mr. Rodriguez when he comes back.
Correct.
And this is of high importance to all of us.
Yeah.
Mayor, I just wanted to point out the staff report for this item says there's an action plan and the city manager and finance director will present it in April. So
it's coming up.
Right. So it looks like this issue is going to be addressed very soon anyways.
I'd also like, if I may, just sort of dovetail into that. When this was written, we had 5 months. Now we're down to 3 months, basically, left in the fiscal year. So no matter what we do, it's not going to have much impact on this fiscal year. This fiscal year is lost. We're going to have $1 million deficit. We need to be planning for next fiscal year and have a much better strategy for where we want to go, what will be our priorities, and how are we going to contain the spending.
Will we be like the U.S. government in deficit spending next year?
Well, we really...
We don't want to do that.
Yeah, we don't print the money, so unfortunately, it'll just be a growing deficit.
Okay.
Well, historically, we've had deficit spending, Keynesian economics. It's not the best thing, but it does happen in our society.
But I think that probably there's a question here. I'm sorry.
Yeah, go ahead.
It's hard to ask Mr. Quinn because he was not here three years ago when you and I started.
Mm-hmm.
We initiated our service in June of 2010 when the city was $5 million deficit.
Oh, so we've done better.
Actually, we did a lot better because in the last 3 years that we've been here, there was no deficit. This is now, is that correct?
Okay.
Is that correct? This is a new development. We have not had a deficit in the last 3 years.
That's correct.
Okay, now, Is this part I was going to bring up? I'm concerned about the long overdue audit. Is this what's going to be revealed on this audit that we've been waiting for, Mr.
Yes.
Quinn? Okay, I am concerned that it's been so long. When are we going to have a full report?
The audit will be done next week, and it'll be presented. We could conceivably present it at the April 1st meeting.
Okay. I feel weird in a sense that we shouldn't wait for the surprise that you've just said we're going to be in debt. Have I missed this? Has this been mentioned before?
Yes.
Well, all due respect, Mayor, we have talked about deficits and...
Oh, no, we always talk about deficits.
Controlling,
I understand
spending
that.
And overtime. And,
right.
And the reports have been
okay.
coming every month.
But I need to go on record by saying that I know that that administration has had meetings with the chief of police, and there have been some acquiescing to the demands of the police department. And I want to find out if those still hold with the city manager, the two officers from Measure H, the promotion of the sergeant. I understand about the deficit, but in my heart, I feel very concerned about public safety. And you may disagree with me, but I think the fire is adequately staffed, but not the police department. That's my strong position. Okay, that's my comment, and I know it will...
Being the chair for the finance,
yeah.
I understand where you're coming from, and I agree that we need public safety for the people of Calexico. But you're going to have to look out and face the city of Calexico and say, you know what, we're going to hire all the policemen that we're supposed to have and do all these other things for the police department. But you're going to tell those employees that from every department, somebody's going to lose their job because you're not going to be able to sustain it. And that's okay. Take care of the safety because it is important. But tell them that some of these people are going to lose their jobs because we have to.
Well, we'll see.
No, it's not we see unless, I mean, you pull money from somewhere else, Mayor. I mean, the numbers are there. They're black and white. They're red right now.
Well, all I know is some promises have been made, and I hope they're carried out. So that's all I'm saying for the police department. And I am concerned about the numbers, but some promises were made by the city manager, and I hope they're carried out.
I have one final question for Mr. Quinn. Mr. Quinn, considering the circumstances, what we're listening to, are we at risk for possible bankruptcy protection?
I don't want to say the bankruptcy word or...
Don't say that word.
I just said it.
The B word.
Or the dire straits stuff. We are in deficit. The deficit will have some impact on the reserves, and the reserves are not enough to carry us more than a year or two.
Well,
more than a year or two.
All right. I respect what you're saying, Mr. Quinn, so let's get together, let's look at it, and like she... Councilwoman Hidal says the numbers, but all I know, though, is certain promises have been made by City Manager Rodriguez with the police department, and then if we need to revisit them and break those promises, I hope not, but I want to see some kind of movement on that. All right. Enough discussion or anybody else?
Mayor, may
I speak? Informational. Go ahead. Would you take over at this moment?
Yeah.
Sorry. Okay. On the issue with JPIA, the general liability for workers' compensation for the city of Calexico, in the fiscal year in July from 2012 through 2013, we pay $1.5 million because of the lawsuits against the city of Calexico. On the next fiscal year, on the 13-14 in July, the city of Calexico paid $2.1 million because of the lawsuits against the city of Calexico.
I'm sorry,
Mr.
sir.
Castro,
where are you?
We are on item 10, which is the overtime. justification, I believe.
Well, let me finish.
We're still
let
on
me
eight.
Finish.
Oh, we are.
Okay. Number eight. Okay, go continue.
Sorry, I thought we had jumped over to 10.
Okay.
Just a clarification.
And on the next fiscal year for 2014 to 2015, imagine we already pay 2.1 on 2013 to 2014. We are going to pay that. Imagine how much we are going to pay on the 2014 to 2015. The lawsuits against the city of Calexico is increasing. Everybody is complaining, and I agree with that. There's no money. We don't have no money to pay officer, to pay employees who are working for the city of Calexico. But guess what? The lack of administration.
Is there a question you have for Mr. Quinn? Is there a question you have for Mr. Quinn?
I'm sorry?
Is there a question you have for Mr. Quinn?
No, let me finish.
Okay.
Let me finish. Okay. Don't interrupt me, John. Please.
All right. Wait,
don't
whoa.
Interrupt me.
Remember our retreat, Councilman Castro.
Yes, yes.
Go right ahead. But
I don't
there's
like
no
to
need.
Interrupt
I understand,
me.
Sir. There's no need to get excited. Say yourself.
I lose
say
my
yourself.
Focus.
Okay, go right ahead, sir. Go right ahead. Calm down. Take a deep breath.
So, that's something that we are really concerned about, the lawsuits against the city of Calexico. The other issue, in order to save money for the city of Calexico, in order to move forward, we need to get rid of the directors who are not doing their job for the city of Calexico. That's what we need to do.
All right.
That's something very serious. And I've been telling you this since I've been here as a council. And Mr. Quinn want to tell us something related to a JPIA, how bad we are paying this amount of millions of dollars because the lack of administration, because those numbers are here on the budget.
Councilman,
those numbers,
Councilman Castro, your time is up. Can you wrap it up, please?
Well, basically, I mean, everybody's complaining, I understand. But we need to take care of our city. We need to focus on the administration. That's it, Mr.
All right. Those are very critical comments, but you have the right to state. Mr. Quinn, do you want to say something?
Mayor, I'd like to comment on those, on Councilman Castro's comments. The numbers are certainly there, but it's not one lawsuit or five lawsuits. It's really the numbers are coming, the claims that are filed against the city that are generated primarily by our police department. Our police claims are far in excess of all of the police claims throughout the county and the cities and the other cities in the county. We far surpass the other police departments in the number of claims that are filed against the city. Those claims, the number of claims and the amount of those claims are what kicks up the increase. It isn't any one specific lawsuit. It's not two specific lawsuits. Although lawsuits do impact it, it is really the number of claims and the claim activity that is generated in the city, and it's very high citywide, and it's primarily through the police department.
All right.
Mayor, may I ask?
Yes, let's keep the respect, but you may ask. Go right ahead.
Mr. Quinn, can you tell me how much the city of Calexico is paying legally, the attorneys, all the personnel are involved on the, I don't know if I say it, correct me if I'm wrong, on the case of Mr. Sandals. How much legally the city of Calexico are paying for that issue? And it's been 2 years on that.
Councilman
it's been 4 years on that. I already asked that question to Mr.
No, I'm worried here.
Rodriguez,
Councilman Castro, may I have some clarification?
Any answer on
City Attorney, does he have, this sounds like a personnel matter. We need to be very careful. I'm not trying to shut you down. I just want, okay, liability here.
The cost spent on that litigation is public
information. All right, you're going to be able to answer.
But I can, I don't have it off the top of my head, or, and I'm sure.
I asked Mr. Quinn.
Maybe Mr. Quinn has it off the top of his head.
Okay. Mr. Quinn, do you need more time to respond to that? Do you have that answer, or?
I don't have that one off the top of my head.
All right. Well, Mr. Councilman Kim, he told you. Will you please respect that?
Councilman Castro.
It's
been 4 years, Mayor, with that problem.
Aren't we on item number 9? I mean,
okay.
Okay, that's it.
All right, thank you.
Mr. Hodge, okay. I have a simple question.
You have what?
Simple question about the budget.
A question. Okay, yes. Go ahead. Question.
I believe the expenditure, so I don't have a page number, expenditure for the general fund.
I'm sorry, Councilman Castro.
General fund, they have a page public safety. The police operation, we have an annual budgeted $6.5 million. Did you get the page?
What page is this, Kim?
I don't have a page.
We're item 8, right? We're on item 8, sir.
Item 8, the general fund expenditure.
The budget for the police department is, the general fund budget is $6.9 million.
Here's a 6.5.
No, it's 6.9, sir.
No, I'm talking about the other pages. The general fund, the expenditure.
Mr. Kim, I prepared the budget at 6.9 million.
All right.
Yes, but here, okay, the total 6.9, but I'm talking about the police operations.
I'm not sure.
Okay.
Whoa.
Let's go to the police police total, 6.9.
Kim, please calm down.
Okay. Available fund is right now, we spent it about half years. We have a $3.3 million available. Is it correct?
I'm not sure where you're looking.
Yeah, same pages. General fund. I wish we have all the page numbers. That way you can have.
I think you're looking at available funds.
Oh, Mr. Kim, you're looking. I see what's going on here. You're saying 6.5, but that's not the total.
Yeah,
that's
six, the first total point. Is a total 6.9.
No,
yeah, I agree
no,
with
excuse me, sir. That's 6.5 for police operations. If you look at the bottom, four lines down, you'll see the total of 6.9 million for total of police.
Okay. Total police is $6.9 million, but we are available fund is $3.3 million.
I'm sorry?
Available fund is $3.3 million.
He's looking at the last column.
Yeah, last column.
Up to $16 million.
Yeah, $3.3 million.
But that's as of December 31st, I believe.
Is that correct?
Yes, I believe so, yeah.
The budget's the same every year.
It's kind of like in a shape. The police expenditure is kind of a shape.
Okay, but the
like
police,
half of you use it.
The police
have, one at a time. Let him speak. Go ahead, Mr. Quinn.
The police have used up in January 31st, the police have used up 60% of the budget.
Councilman Kim?
January 1st is 60% of the budget?
Of the general budget or of their budget?
Of the general fund, of their general fund budget.
Of their
police
general.
Budget.
Police budget.
Yeah, up to the January, 60%.
They have used up 60% of the general fund police budget of $6.9 million.
Which is 10% over. Because there should be a 50% in January.
Okay, now we're all interjecting. Mr.
I just want clarification.
Okay, please. Yeah.
No, this is just up to the January, so like we've been 7 months, we've been spent 60%. Am I correct?
At the end of January, that's the seventh month, yes.
7 months, we spend 60%.
60%.
So which is kind of like we're spending, it's like almost the same speed, the year budget.
Well, it's not kind of, it's not half pregnant, it's over.
Okay, I understand that.
That was easy to understand.
All right.
If I may point out one more thing, Mayor, please.
Yes.
If you go back back on page, there's a bunch of detail sheets, and in there, at the beginning of the police section, is a breakdown of the general fund budget, but it also shows that the police are not only getting a $6.9 million budget from the general fund, but the police also are getting another 1.1 or 1,075,000 from Measure H and grants, all that other support. So their overall budget that they have to spend in addition to the general fund is $8 million, 7.9, $8 million. That is, in fact, the total budget for the police department.
All right, sir.
And I think that's very important to understand, right, because that extra $1 million is somewhat dependent on the grant money being there, and they've already overspent that by $350,000, as I mentioned earlier.
All right. I'd like to put an end to this. I think we've beat this over the head plenty of times here. So everybody's had a chance. So let's to comment. We agree to disagree and respect each other. So let's move on. Thank you, Mr. Quinn. Thank you for your patience and your explanation. All right, let's move on to item number 9. And I believe this is, correct me if I'm wrong, is this the last item for the evening? Yes or no? There's a 10? I don't, because I lost.
Two more.
After this?
We have 9 and 10.
9 and 10. All right. It is recommended, this is item number 9, that the City Council receive and file business license fee survey conducted February 27th, 2014. And this is informational, correct? All right. I've looked at this. If I have any concerns, I'll come see you, Mr. Quinn. Anybody have any comments or concerns?
Yes, I do.
All right, please keep it brief if you can.
Sure.
Councilman Kim, go ahead.
I believe this is informational ones, but there's no information.
Say that again, sir.
This informational one, but there's no information about this.
No numbers.
Because no numbers. Nothing there.
Okay, slow down, guys. Make your comment, it will be received.
Yeah,
so your comment is that there is no numbers.
There's no numbers.
Okay.
It's just about how much increase or not, but there's no numbers we can see, we can compare with the other cities.
So you're making a request that we have some numbers next
time?
Yes,
please.
All right. Okay, duly noted. Really, you want to respond, Mr. Quinn?
Well,
okay.
I can respond to that.
Well, Mr. Quinn's very eager. Go ahead, Mr. Quinn.
Mayor, members of the council, the request was that we get a comparative look at Calexico versus the other cities in Imperial County, or other cities for that matter. And it was for the business license fee. The business, we found out through telephone survey with the other cities that, in fact, their business license fee is no different than ours. Where all of these go different is when you look at things like the fire inspection fee, you look at the other fees that come through the planning department, the planning
okay.
fee, and similar fees, all of those may vary considerably
high.
From one city to the next.
Mm-hmm. Considerable difference.
So all we did was answer the initial request, which was to compare the business license fee.
All right.
Yes, that's why I believe the business license has to be with the number, all the factor like fire inspection fees, all the inspection fees supposed to be there. So we like to see all the detail so we can compare ourselves which areas we're charging too much or too less.
Those things are online. You can go online to any of their websites and see those fees.
Of other cities.
Would you bring it?
It's silly to take staff time to do that, to be honest. Mm-hmm.
I think, may I interject?
Go ahead.
I remember when the councilman requested this item, I remembered that this was going to be confusing again because this is like the third time that we've talked about business licenses. And because our business license fee, let's say, for example, at any business downtown, it's $187, that is broken. I'm just throwing out numbers. The $187 is going to be broken down. A portion of the $187 is for business license.
Fire.
Another portion will be for fire. So when we as council request information about business license,
that's what you get.
Your staff is looking at solely business license. So when we asked our staff to do this work, and I didn't want to interject because I wasn't sure what was going on and what the real request was, but if we really want to look at the big picture, we need to ensure and be sensitive to our staff's time and ensure that our requests are precise.
Okay, duly noted.
Well, during the briefing, I request the city manager. City manager told me to he's going to talk to the staff to provide the information during this meeting. That's what I was expecting. I'm going to have it
tonight.
Yes, and he's not there.
All right. So the thing is that we all as council would like to see the same information. Once one councilman is bringing that information request up, then we all would like to then be interested in how these are broken down. So I think what it is that when we have an intention to ensure that we are relaying and actually ensuring that we're telling who we're asking for this information to be precise, we can't read minds. I guess that's what it is.
Okay.
I know I don't have a paper, but we've been looking at this license fees for the last 3 years since I've been here. When Carl Hargrave was the chairperson of the finance advisory, we've been going back and forth, bringing the same information. The business license is one thing, the other inspections are the other. I mean, you don't have the staff, the time, the people to do this. Focus on the other things, please.
All right.
Mayor.
Go ahead, Councilman Castro.
Thank you. I have an example that in the city of Calexico, for example, Jam Jam Restaurant. Jam Jam Restaurant for a business license fee pay like almost $1,200. $1,200, that means $1,200.
Business license fees.
Business, I'm talking about business license. That's one example. In El Centro, Dennis, the one on the Dogwood, I believe, yeah, the Dennis restaurant, the one on Dogwood, in the mall in El Centro, you know how much they pay for the business license annually? They pay $450. Look at the difference. It's very clear. We are talking about Denny's. It's a franchise restaurant, and they pay $450. That's one example. The merchants from the swap meet, they don't pay no less from the swap meet, no less than $250. And there is so many examples, but we are talking about probably 50% difference from other cities. You know what? I'm concerning on this issue because if you pass through our First Street in downtown, there is so many empty business. Why? Because this is the most expensive city in the whole valley. Wow. Let me finish.
Okay.
Let me finish. This is the most expensive city in the whole valley. I mean, are we going to work in order to maintain the same business, and also to invite some other businesses from other areas? I mean, I'm concerning because, I mean, the majority of the people, I know, they pass through downtown Calexico, and there are so many empty locals or business. That's about it. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman Castro. I'd like to put
in regards to downtown,
closure to this. Go ahead.
The reason you have a lot of empty spaces is because your landlords charge expensive high rents. And nobody is going to come in and rent from there when they have to sell at a very low margin. when the rents are too high, so they have to move somewhere else.
I believe that, Jolie. I believe 100%. You're right.
And there's other issues.
Okay? You're right.
That's the number one thing, and we have talked about doing something several months ago, but we didn't get it done. Two, the reason, you know, you say like Yum Yum has a license for $1,200. It has to do, it's the business license, plus the other inspections that are intact into it, which has to do the Minimax or Maximax or whatever.
Maximus study.
That one, which hasn't gone back. I mean, there's a long laundry list, okay? But right now, we have some bigger priorities. And like you say, the other cities are different. Well, the other cities don't have a city council like the one we have right now. You know, we have it in the last 10 years. We've had, I already lost count, 7 or 8 city managers. It's been a revolving door in this city. I've lived here all my life. And I mean, the comments are, this has been the worst city council that we've had because we can't get nothing done. I think it's getting worse in Washington. But anyway, I'm on my volunteer time here. I got late because I was still working with a client, but I love my city. But I do all my business in El Centro, and I do some business here. But if I didn't give a hoot, why should I? I should be having dinner with my husband.
You should.
I should. But he knows how passionate I am for Calexico. He says, you go get him, honey. And that's what I do. Oh. And I come here and I fight and I fight. And it'll come one year and it'll come out the other. You know? But it's your job and your responsibility because you guys got voted into here to do the right job. But everybody, it's like, when you call these people, Yoli, when I called you to come to my meeting and I called John to come, and I know you guys are busy. And what did they, this was this comment I got from the outside. Get each one from each district.
I'm sorry. Yeah. It's going to be this Thursday, right?
No, it was already this Monday.
Oh. It's every Monday.
Okay, let's, can we?
Anyway, thank you.
Please, let's conclude this. Yolanda, I tend to disagree. I think we got some merit here at the City Council. It's just a matter of lots of disagreements, but it's a matter of getting to the truth.
I think we need to defend the staff of the City of Calexico one more time.
Okay.
The City of Calexico, the reason, and we're going to talk business license only, okay? This is not the other fees, business license only. We at the City of Calexico have a certified financial officer that is trained in an association of financial officers for cities, and this staff member is up to date in what California is doing as far as sales tax, how you collect sales tax, and the different regulations and everything pertaining to sales tax. So as far as I understand and the knowledge that I have had learning about that is that no other city in the valley has any officers going to that association. We do. We are very unique here at the border. We have a lot of interest from the south of the border for businesses in this city. And if we don't capitalize on that, then we would not be taking full advantage of this potential. So I just wanted to make sure we all understood that the City of Calexico does have a financial, certified financial officer who is highly trained every year, and I think it's sometimes even twice a year. Thank you.
All right. I could say a lot, but I don't want to. All right, let's move on to item number 10, because we just keep going around in circles and circles. Okay.
Just giving them.
Acknowledgement of overtime justification report for the month of January 2014.
So
this is informational.
Acknowledge.
I'm sorry, sir.
I acknowledge it.
You acknowledge it. Thank you. All right. Does everybody else acknowledge it?
Yes.
All right. I would like to make a request. Wow.
You want to go home?
Yeah. I think city council members, I think we've made a lot of future agenda items. And you said respect for the staff. I think they're piling up. I've requested a couple. They haven't come forward. I think we should not do any future agenda items tonight, but ask for an update of the ones we have and where they are and when they're coming forward. And I was told that was going to happen. So, Nick, can you move on that?
I will.
And City Attorney, I don't know. I feel we have a need, all five of us, I don't know how, public forum, so that we could get definite information and have some kind of public workshop about our budget and overtime. You know, I mean, we might still wrangle, but if we got the numbers and we got the documents, the truth will be said, and we can come to some kind of understanding, because we all have different strong opinions, and I respect that, but we need to get to the truth. So is there a way that we can be together as five and have a workshop? The public wouldn't be invited, but on the budget, on the overtime? Does that make sense?
Yes.
Did you say public would be invited?
Well, I'm asking you, do they have to?
Yes.
I mean, they have to.
Yes.
It has to be a workshop. Uh-huh. I want a workshop.
Yes, I believe
okay.
You should.
And then our fellow councilmen can bring their information. You have your information. We can look at both. We can come to the truth.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Because we need to have some kind of common understanding so we can move forward. And right now, we have a lot of disagreement, a mistrust, and that's not good. Okay? That's not good. Okay? All right. So do you acknowledge, do you agree that we don't do any future agenda items?
Here.
All right. I hear.
Have some urgent.
Okay. I would like to adjourn this meeting. I'm sorry. Let's
Mayor,
adjourn.
Go ahead and take a motion to adjourn. To
okay.
See if
okay.
Have...
Is there a motion to
so
adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Is there a second? We'll vote. Okay. Okay. All right. It's not because your future gen items are not important, but we're backed up. We have a lot. And I know some of you have been patiently waiting for them, and we need to see what's happening.
And
so,
Mayor, I just might add, there is the agenda policy allows for council members to make requests for future agenda items outside the council
That's
meeting.
Right. So tomorrow you can come in tomorrow and to do it if you want. But here we go. This meeting is adjourned. Whew.